one of the problems that new parents have is that they bring this baby into the world, this other person into their home, and then they try to pretend that that's not going to involve them, that that's not going to change their entire existence. And it so certainly does. Everything changes. Again, from the moment the pea hits the stick, everything changes. And they need to embrace the idea that they will never be the same again. And when you can embrace that idea, it's so much easier to work baby into your environment. But when you try to force baby to fit into your preconceived fantasy notions, it's doomed to failure.
Balloons, bazookas, boobies, bosoms, boulders, cans, hooters, knockers, melons, honkers, jugs, rack, tatas, tits, torpedoes, guns, bust, doorknobs, coconuts, and our favorite one, the girls. Welcome to the All About Breastfeeding Show, where your host, Lori, highlights mothers just like yourself and goes beyond the surface questions and digs deep so they share not only their joys and happiness in their daily breastfeeding life, but also their pain and struggles and how they worked through them.
Episode number 194. Welcome to All About Breastfeeding, the place where the girls hang out. I am your host, Lori Jill Isenstadt, IBCLC, which stands for International Board Certified Lactation Consultant, and I help moms with breastfeeding. You can go to allaboutbreastfeeding.biz to learn more about me and the services I provide. Oh my goodness, everyone, you are in for a real treat today. I love all my guests as they each bring something different to the table. And my new friend Tom, well, he definitely brings something new to the table. How about, I should say, a whole new chapter? I would title it, How to Gain Dad's Interest in Birth, Breastfeeding, and Newborn Parenting, Tips from a Guy's Perspective. You know how I like to start most shows with a quote from my guest? Well, with Tom, almost every other sentence was quotable. Every time I thought I chose one, another one came around. I finally did have to make a choice, but no worries, because you will hear all of his tips and tricks and his fabulous sense of humor throughout the show today. What are we going to learn about from today's show? Well, let me fill you in on just a few things. Let's see, why dads need to wear pasties. What is so great about dad's Adam's apples? Why he tells dads that they will never be 18 again. How Tom responds when guys say, I'm jealous. How am I going to bond with my baby if I never get to feed my baby? This is a show that you are definitely going to want to share with dads. One last note. I got excited and I talked over Tom a few times. And I know you're going to hear this, as it was not possible to edit the audio to make everything clear. I do apologize to you, my listeners, and to Tom when you hear me over-talking him. This is one of the hazards of enjoying your guest just a little too much. All right, let's get started with today's show. Tom Johnston obtained his bachelor's degree in nursing at Austin P. State University in Clarksville, Tennessee, and his master's in midwifery at the University of Rhode Island in Kingston, Rhode Island. That's right, midwife. He is also a lactation consultant. He retired from the Army as the chief of midwifery services for Womack Army Medical Center in Fort Bragg, North Carolina, after 27 years of service. He now uses his unique perspective to instill information and enthusiasm about maternal child nursing to undergraduate nursing students at Methodist University in Fayetteville, North Carolina. Tom is an avid speaker on such topics as the father's role and the stigma of breastfeeding in the general public. He is the author of various publications on breastfeeding and frequently blogs on his site, Sage Owns Breastfeeding Blog. Welcome to the show, Tom. We are thrilled to have you here with all of your not only years of experience, but I'm sure that you already know this. You're not necessarily an anomaly, but we're not used to seeing male midwives and male lactation consultants. And I know you know that.
Yeah, this is true. You know, thanks for having me. It's always fun to get on and talk to folks about breastfeeding.
You're welcome. And sometimes I feel funny doing this because I know that you've answered this a gazillion times, but my listeners, more than likely for a lot of them, it's the first time they're hearing from you. If you can kind of sum up, you know, how you really started into the midwifery and breastfeeding field, which I would love to hear about.
Well, sure. Well, you know, it was a long and kind of twisted path. It really didn't have a lot of direction. I was a worthless high school student with a 2.2 GPA, and I joined the Army one day kind of accidentally as a junior in high school. I started out as an Army medic, and then when I went to active duty, I changed over to be a hospital cook just because it wasn't being a medic. Did that for a few years. I met and married my lovely wife, who was a neonatal intensive care nurse at the time, and I kind of saw that, you know, being an officer in the Army was a good way to go. And so I told the Army I was going to get out and go become a history professor so I could come back in and be an Army officer. And they said, no, don't get out and do that. I'll send you to nursing school. I literally asked, what do nurses do for a living? And my boss said, oh, I don't know. You'll figure it out when you get there. So I went to nursing school. Nursing school was fun, and I hated endocrinology and psych. So, of course, when I went to get my master's degree in the Army offered me midwife. When I asked why, they said, well, because all your bosses said you'd make a good midwife, go to midwife school. So that's how I became a midwife. I've loved my time as an Army officer, as a nurse, as a midwife. I really enjoyed it. But the only thing I ever actually chose to do was to become a lactation consultant. That was the one thing that I fell deeply in love with and said, I want to be a lactation consultant. Lo and behold, after 27 years in the Army, I got to become a lactation consultant. I got certified back in, 2002? But I never got to use it because I was a midwife in the Army and that was my job. But now that I'm retired, I can go back and be a professor and a lactation consultant and finally do what I wanted to do. So that's kind of how I ended up where I am.
You just kind of fell into these things. I wonder what it is they saw in you that they said, go to midwifery school. It looks like you'd make a good midwife.
Well, you know, I was working as a labor and delivery nurse. And every year in the Army, you get these officer evaluation reports. And your senior rater, your senior boss, puts down three jobs that they think that you would be good at. Be a teacher at the academy, be a company commander, whatever. And every year they put, you know, send to midwifery school. But they put that on everybody's evaluation because it was labor and delivery. And so I never took them seriously. And, you know, word of advice to any of you young Army officers out there, take them seriously. Whatever they put on that is where you're going to go because that's what happened.
You know, I'm glad that you shared that with us. It's really interesting to see how things can kind of turn the events in life as you're just passing through.
Yeah. Well, you know, Kurt Vonnegut wrote a story. I think it was Fahrenheit 451. I'm not sure. But there's a character in there named Billy, and Billy is constantly being pulled through time and space. And the running gag in the book was everything was always okay with Billy. And that was kind of me. Whatever the Army told me to do, I was okay with it. You want me to be a cook? I'll go be a cook. You want me to be a nurse? I'll go be a nurse. Whatever you want, I'll do.
And not only that, you kind of went along with the program, but you were really happy doing so.
It's always been I'm kind of a fatalist. Whatever happens, happens, and it happens for a reason. And so I'm always okay with it. And the Army always had my interest at heart. You know, a life of service is very rewarding, especially when you let the Army kind of guide you through the process. And so, yeah, I was, you know, I always bloom where I'm planted. Wherever I'm told to do next, I'll go do it. That's just kind of my life. And it's a great way to get it to succeed if you're a soldier.
Is that one of your general philosophies in raising your children?
Oh, absolutely. And I pass it on to them too. Just go along with the program. You'll be fine. You can influence it once in a while, but people have your best interests at heart. Go on. See what you got.
Let's have you tell us a little bit about your family life and your children now that you've told us gotten us to speed as to why you're doing what you're currently doing. Tell us about family life and kids.
Sure. Well, you know, it's not really mentioned in my bio, I don't think. I'm the father of eight children. You know, my wife and I just love having kids. She is a neonatal intensive care nurse. I'm a midwife. we kind of understand babies better than the average couple. So yeah, we had a whole bunch of kids. That's why most people want to hear about me and fatherhood, because I kind of live what I teach, right? Or I practice what I preach, right? I have 8 children from 22 to almost 7. And we live happily here in North Carolina. Busy, busy life, but it's fun. Absolutely.
Well, when you talk about work-life balance, which a lot of people talk about that, and I don't necessarily know about that phrase, but when I do think about work-life balance with both of you and having 8 children, there was times when I assume your wife worked during pregnancies and then took off for a short time, and I know she breastfed. So you're going to have to kind of tell us in a little, like, how did all that work?
I speak at a lot of high schools in various like medical programs, and I get that question from time to time. Tell me about the work-life balance of being a midwife and or being a nurse and I'm like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Work-life balance. It's just life. I don't know what work-life balance is. My wife worked full-time until baby number 7 was born, and then when baby number 7 was born, the Army moved us to a place where they didn't have Army nurses. And so she stopped working. She wasn't in the Army, but she always worked in Army hospitals. She was no longer in the Army, but she had always worked in Army hospitals. And when we went to upstate New York and there was no Army hospital to work, she decided that was a good time to pull back and be a full-time mom. And that was, gosh, I guess 9 years ago. And she's been pretty happy staying home, taking care of the children. You know, I never say my wife doesn't work. My wife works all the time, all day, every day, but she works in the home.
Yeah, I always say it's kind of full-time 24/7 that you don't get cash for. You don't get paid for.
Exactly. Yeah, and I couldn't afford to pay what she's worth. My goodness.
Oh, yeah. Do you ever see those figures, what it would cost to have a full-time person take care of your family? It's like over $100,000.
Oh, much, much more than that. I'd need an entire staff.
Yes.
I would need... You know, my goodness, a social secretary, a nanny, a head cook and bottle washer. I need 6 or 7 people to replace her.
A psychiatrist.
Psychiatrist.
Just one of everything.
A mentor, a life coach. Yeah,
yes,
exactly.
I know. When you really figure all that out. What I'd love to talk about is breastfeeding. And I guess I'm first interested because you spent so many years as a midwife. What was your relationship with working with women in breastfeeding at that point? Were you pretty much leaving it up to the lactation consultants? Was your thing to be there just for the first latch or so? Or what kind of breastfeeding support did you give as a midwife in the Army?
Well, I firmly believe that all healthcare providers play a role in lactation, whether they think they do or not. But, you know, if half the population is women and 85% of women are going to have a baby during their childbearing years, you're going to see lactation all day, every day. And most people just ignore the fact that they're taking care of lactating women. So as a midwife, I always felt my role started from the moment the pee hit the stick, the first OB visit, I start talking about breastfeeding with, tell me what you know about it. And then every prenatal visit, I give them some homework, mom and dad. I give them homework, go learn about this and come back and see me, you know, for your next visit. And it kind of builds all the way through the pregnancy. And then, of course, it's all about protecting the breastfeeding relationship by limiting your labor interventions while you're providing labor support. And then, you know, of course, getting the baby skin to skin immediately and on the breast in the first hour or two is helpful. And then my general advice for all new moms is to shut the door, put a big no visitor sign on the door, and do nothing but hold your baby for the first 48 to 72 hours. And then breastfeeding is a cinch. And then, of course, there's the guiding for the next couple of months after that. So as a midwife, I felt that was primarily where I focused. You know, some troubleshooting when they would come in for other, you know, related causes. But the bulk of it, I think, as a midwife is in prenatal education and then supporting the process as it works through. As you probably know, lactation consultants are still pretty rare in America. And so, you know, my hospital only had a few, and that's more than the average hospitals have. So I saw a lot of women who weren't my patients, so to speak, but came to me because I was a healthcare provider who knew about lactation. But yeah, so that's kind of what I did.
I love how you just started off by saying that you feel that it all starts when the pee hits the stick.
Yeah, I picked that phrase up. I was in a perinatal conference and it was a young doula who was explaining what she did. And that I stole that phrase from her, that her job starts when the pee hits the stick.
It's a fun one. I don't know about you and the work that you do, but I often say sometimes I get tired of hearing myself say things the same way. And so I'm always looking for some things that will make it a little bit more interesting, but it also has to feel right by me. Cause otherwise if I have to memorize something, it's not going to work. But the whole pee hit the stick thing is that's like my good sense of humor and that'll work for me. So I'm going to steal that too.
Feel free.
Do you have any idea if your mom breastfed you?
That is the family lore, that my mom breastfed me. It wouldn't surprise me in the least. I'm from a large blended family. I believe there were 10 of us all together. There were some in my family that were so old when I was born, I never really met them. But yeah, my mom claims to have breastfed us. That was the early 70s, so breastfeeding rates were abysmal back then. I don't know how long I was breastfed or any of that. But I know when my sister had babies, my mom encouraged her to breastfeed them. So it sounds right.
That's cool. Now, you know, you've been doing midwifery for such a long time. So 27, 30 years ago, it was pretty abysmal. So you've probably seen a lot of changes come at least in the initiation rate with breastfeeding and the use of formula.
Oh, absolutely. So I've only been doing maternal child nursing since 1998. The first 8 years in the Army, I was a cook and a medic. So I wasn't really on the maternal child side or the nursing side. But yeah, you know, when I first came into the field, the reason I got into lactation was because it was what everybody did the worst. People were horrible at it. And my wife, as a NICU nurse, her staff that she worked with were very pro breastfeeding and breast milk for all the NICU babies. And my wife was very pro breastfeeding. And it was really her influence in breastfeeding that got me into it. You know, I had an excellent partner to bounce ideas off of. And as I learned, you know, she was an early mentor of mine on the lactation field. But yeah, I mean, you know, it used to be that, you know, it was like a 50-50 breastfeeding rate, but the 6-week success rate was almost zero, you know. And now, of course, we've moved to the idea where everybody breastfeeds, but still the 6-week breastfeeding rate is not very good. And the 6-month breastfeeding rate is even worse, you know, but it's so much better than it was 20 years ago, light years better. And whenever I hear young lactation folks, complain about the way the world is, I think, oh, back in my day, you know, back in my day, it was so much worse. You know, things have come so far, even though it doesn't feel like it, they've come so far. And I'm sure that, you know, I have some older mentors in lactation, like Linda Smith and Lisa Marasco, and some of the folks who were around at the very beginning, Kathy Carruthers and those folks that I'm sure that when I used to complain, they have probably had the same thought. You know, it's like a grandmother, father, child relationship kind of thing.
Exactly. And it's interesting that you talk about the race. I have so many people who just, they can't believe, because especially now, like you said, probably about 85% of moms are initiating breastfeeding, but the rates 4 weeks, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 3 months later are, I think, pretty poor. I mean, I'm glad so many more moms are starting out breastfeeding, but we still have a long way to go. And I remember that as the rates started increasing, the mindset was also interesting in how that has evolved, because maybe 20 years ago or so, the rates started increasing. But then moms had this thing of, well, I'll only breastfeed until just for the colostrum, because I heard that's the best part, right? Do you remember hearing that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, of course. Yeah, sure. You know, it's funny. While you were speaking, I was thinking, if you read some of the older literature, they used to talk about this intervention and whether or not it enabled breastfeeding at 2 weeks or 4 weeks or 6 weeks. Now, if you go to the literature today, you can't find anything measuring breastfeeding success at 2 weeks or 6 weeks. It's always 4 months, 6 months, 12 months that they're looking at these days. So even our science has evolved to the point where we no longer look at, you know, that early breastfeeding failure, that everyone's expecting 2 months. But if you have time, I'll tell you a fun story. So, you know, I start every prenatal visit with, what have you learned about breastfeeding since the last time I saw you? And the first visit is always, what do you know about breastfeeding? And I had this one woman once who I said, what do you know about breastfeeding? And she said, oh, I'm not breastfeeding. That's just not natural. And I said, wow, that's interesting. I've heard about people like you, but I've never met anyone like you. Can we explore this together? And she was more than willing to explore it. And, you know, her idea was that animals breastfeed, the humans aren't animals. And so it's just not natural for humans to breastfeed. And so, you know, we talked a little bit and I gave her some homework to go off and explore and come back. And I tell all my patients, if you want to talk about breastfeeding, that's what I'm going to do. If you don't want to talk about breastfeeding, I won't. I'm going to talk about it anyway. So please don't come back to me if you don't want to talk about breastfeeding. So she came back and she kept coming back her whole pregnancy. And as we moved through pregnancy, it was, maybe I'll pump and give him colostrum while we're in the hospital. Great job, Mom. That's a great idea. Then maybe I'll breastfeed while we're in the hospital because I understand that pumping is not so good for colostrum. Wonderful, Mom. That's a great idea. Maybe I'll just breastfeed until I go back to work. Maybe, and it just kept getting bigger as we went through the pregnancy. Lo and behold, the baby breastfed like he was born to do it. Ha ha. The kid was an excellent nurser and she breastfed well. And she was still breastfeeding at her 2-month well mother checkup. And then I got a call from her when the baby was about a year old. And she said, help, Tom, I'm trying to get pregnant, but my baby won't stop breastfeeding. What do I do? And I was like, hey. So she, you know, it starts with little victories and then you build them one victory at a time.
I just love that approach. Here's a little information. Go home and do some homework and come back next month and we'll talk more.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it works like a charm. And unfortunately, you can't do that as a lactation consultant because you don't see them prenatally. That's where healthcare providers have to play a big piece, a big part in the team.
Yeah. And I do have a small clientele of moms who do come beforehand. And typically they're coming beforehand because they've had a horrific experience before and they're looking to change. Or they're just, There's just some, issues and anxiety surrounding it, like a very heightened one. And they really want to talk it through. And I love seeing both of those moms because the woman who has the issues and anxiety is not thrilled that she has that, but it gives her the opportunity to talk it through to someone separate than her partner or a good friend who can see things a little bit differently. And lots of times, and I know that you know this, sometimes it's just talking it out that like, oh, it just relieves us of all this emotional burden. And then it frees the way to explore more. So when they come and they just get to talk about it ahead of time, it's wonderful.
Sure. And I use it as a time to kind of troubleshoot, to prepare for the next one. You know, this is what you did that wasn't necessarily therapeutic. Maybe with this time we can practice this instead. I think that's an excellent teaching tool. I have a small home health lactation practice where I go to people's homes here in the Fayetteville area. And unfortunately, all I ever get is the real complicated cases, right? Because who's going to call a lactation consultant when everything is going great?
All we think is that women have problems. And I always say there's tons of women who the baby's born to breastfeed. It just seems to work and she doesn't have any problems. But yes, I see all the people who do have problems, even though I know that's not that way in the whole real world, but that is a bulk of who I see, right?
Exactly. Yeah. It's you know, we always see, I mean, we're experts, right? As a lactation consultant, we are the expert in feeding and we're who you go to when you need an expert. And unfortunately, that leaves us a little bit jaded sometimes where we forget that there's all this normal breastfeeding going on.
Right. I always say, thank goodness for, I did breastfeeding mothers groups for years. And I always say, thank goodness for my peers, for what I saw before I even became a lactation consultant and for the breastfeeding groups, because it is a constant reminder. Yes, breastfeeding works for many, many people and they don't need us. We just see the people who are having problems and challenges and they're willing to come see someone and say, help me.
Yep, exactly. It's a little bit like birth. You know, midwives are the expert of normal and we see normal labor and birth all day, every day. It's what we do. But our obstetrician colleagues, they only see the high risk population. And so they always think that all birth is complicated and you have to medicalize it and control it because they've lost focus in what normal looks like. And it's an interesting mental adjustment, I think, that people have to make.
Yeah, that actually reminds me of a midwife friend that I had many years ago who was in the Army and did you OB in the Army and then came out and was a midwife. But when she mentored younger midwives
And they saw like two or three or four or five great bursts, and they were on this high and everything went beautiful. And then they think they can kind of like hang up their shingle and start seeing moms for birth. She would tell them that one of the reasons why I'm a great midwife is because I got to see many, many complications. And so I can see and know and sense when things are going wrong. And that enables me to be a great midwife for the normal. And I'm able to see if something is going wrong. So you're not a great midwife if all you get to see is all the really great, beautiful, uncomplicated births. And I remember for the group of people that she was speaking to at the time, that was a pretty big downer, because they thought, oh, wow, I've been to a bunch of births. I got it made in the shade.
Sure. Yeah, that's great. I mean, and that's a really interesting side concept, the idea of like pattern recognition and being able to see when badness is happening. I love to do it with my nursing students. You know, they start early on and we're in the sim labs and it's just chaos every single time, because they miss the little cues that we give until the patient starts to crash. And then as they progress through, by their senior year, their final practicum, it's a really complicated case and they don't even see it. They're waiting for the chaos to happen and it never happens because they've cut it off at the pass along the way. They take a vital sign and then they respond to the abnormal vital sign instead of taking the vital sign and ignoring it. So they learn to recognize what's going on and kind of cut it off. And then, you know, nursing looks easy when you recognize it, as does birth, as does lactation. When you can see it coming before the badness happens and head it off at the pass, that's where expertise really.
What I say with especially midwives who are doing birth at home, and people kind of freak out at that. And I'm like, you know, they're experts. They're going to see when things are going south. They're not going to wait for it to be an emergency, knowing 5 minutes, you know, a couple minutes away is they can do something in emergency. And there's nothing better for a midwife. And I don't know about how you feel, but most of the midwives I know, to be able to say, I'm just sitting on my hands watching it all unfold.
Oh, absolutely. I love labor sitting. One of my early mentors was Deb Erickson Owens and Judy Mercer there up in Rhode Island. They used to talk about this midwife who would sit in the corner and knit all day during labor. She wasn't really making anything. She was just knitting. But it was a way to appear to be in control and to focus on, to make it look like she wasn't staring at the mother while she was laboring. I can't knit, so I would usually sit in the room in the rocking chair and hold my phone in my hand as though I were doing something on my phone. And I wasn't. I was watching the entire room, listening to the fetal monitor, listening to the mother, and waiting for, you know, just kind of monitoring, looking for the opportunity where, you know, something where they're going to need me for something. It gives the mothers this sense of everything is okay. So if there was something wrong, surely the midwife would have intervened, you know, and so it must be okay. And then every once in a while, mom will make a sound and you go, I'm sorry, did you say something? did you grunt funny like you're ready to push? You know, or you know, the baby's heart rate will take a little variable or something. And you're like, oh, that's an interesting sound that the baby just made. Maybe we need to intervene now a little bit. That little kind of passive birth sitting, watching like a hawk. It's one of those quintessential midwife skills that I think that every good midwife needs to be able to do. But, you know, I think we're supposed to be talking about dads
yes,
and breastfeeding.
So I would love for you to tell me, it's going back a while, but I would love for you to, what it was like for you with your very first baby, because a lot of my listeners are pregnant for the first time. Some of them just had new babies. And I'd love for you to take it from the guy, the dad's perspective, from that very first time, and then how that has evolved for you.
Sure. Well, you know, when baby number one was born, I was an Army hospital cook, and I was a young enlisted man, E4, maybe an early E5, a young sergeant. And I didn't know a thing about it. I was totally clueless. But my wife, God love her, she's a NICU nurse. She knows everything about it. So, you know, I went to the prenatal visits and I got ignored like every other father gets ignored. And I really didn't have anything to do with anything. I just kind of was on autopilot and didn't even recognize what I was missing. You know, when baby was born, and you know, he was so beautiful, and that kid is now an Army officer himself, and you know, breastfeeding just worked like a charm. And I watched my wife do it, and like all dads, I got her a good cup of water, I held the baby while she got ready, I, you know, did the things that they tell dads that they're useful at. But I was worthless when it came to breastfeeding support. I couldn't assess a latch or anything like that. That was never in my playbook. but I was a very actively involved father. And then when baby number two was born, I was a nursing student. And then my wife had bought me this coach's kit, and it was a gag gift. It had this bright yellow baseball cap with a yellow stopwatch and these flashcards. And on one side, it would say, "You're doing great, baby. I love you so much." And on the other side, it would say things like, "Your wife is now in the first stage of labor. Her contractions are 3 to 5 minutes apart, and she may be experiencing this." And so it was like you could hold the flashcard up for her, but on the back, it would give me what things to do. And it was a gag gift, but it was really wonderful. And I became very involved as an active labor coach. And then when it came time to start pushing, you know, the nurses literally put a chair in the corner and sat me in the corner and said, "Here, Dad, you sit here and stay out of the way while we work here." I let them do that once. And then I pushed the chair aside to get out of my way. I know what I'm doing. Let me in here. That was my watershed moment where I realized that the dads are pretty much ignored in the whole birth arena, but they're so much more useful than that. And so from that experience, you know, it kind of built. I became a labor and delivery nurse and focused a lot on how I could bring dads into the experience. And then, of course, in breastfeeding, the same thing. I figured out that dads are useful partners. They're not actually disinterested. It's just that nurses and lactation consultants are usually women. And so they don't know how to speak to husbands or fathers. I joke in my lectures that they don't speak boy very well. But I'm a boy, and I'm boy-lingual. I'm both a boy and a midwife, so I can speak both languages really well. I realize that most of what we teach is focused on women. You know, it's pink and pastel and beautiful, and isn't this lovely, and all these emotions, and isn't that great, which works very well for most women. But it doesn't speak to men at all. And men are just totally disinterested in what you're saying. So when you want to speak to a father, you have to speak from a male perspective. You have to use humor and analogy, and you have to give them real world tasks to accomplish. Men aren't interested in how beautiful everything is. They may say it out loud, but they really could care less. They're interested in, what can I do to help? What can I do to make it better? And here is the big kicker that I try to get everyone to understand. No matter how much you like that patient, you're probably not going to be there at 3 o'clock in the morning when she's having breastfeeding problems. But he is. So if you can encourage dad to learn how to breastfeed, then mom will have somebody there 24/7 to help her with her breastfeeding problems. And that is the game changer. There's plenty of evidence out there that dads who are supportive have moms who support, who breastfeed better. And there's some evidence where they actually train dads in troubleshooting, and they show that dads are more successful than lactation consultants at solving the problem. Absolutely.
Before you mentioned how you start talking to moms at that very first prenatal visit, what are some of the things that you do with their partners, with the guys at that first prenatal visit or subsequent ones to help them do exactly what you said? Now, I want to talk about breastfeeding class in a few minutes, but I'm really interested in what you do at prenatal appointments to really bring him in and gain his interest. And like you said, they're not necessarily interested in the beauty and the wonder and that kind of bonding stuff that we talk about. What is it that gains guys' interest? What do you do?
Well, they want to know how they can help. And so just at every visit, I have the man and woman sitting side by side in front of me. I don't have dad off in a corner, so I have to turn my head toward him to talk. I have them both sitting in front of me. And so I speak to both of them at the same time. And I say, "Mom, what do you know about breastfeeding?" And then I say, "Dad, what do you know about breastfeeding?" Dad's answer is usually, "I don't know anything about it." But every once in a while, you get those overachiever dads who are really into it. Those are fun. They're kind of on autopilot. But the ones who start off with, "I don't know anything about it," I focus on them just like I focus on mom. And I always tell people that a midwife's job is not to catch babies. Any trained monkey can do that. What a midwife does, and lactation consultants too, is we help couples turn into families. And so it's not about the mom and the baby. It's about all three of them together, that all three of them are my focus. All three of them are my patient, so to speak. And so every single visit, I have something for mom and I have something for dad at every visit. And I give them each homework to do based on who they are and where they are in their learning process. You know, I talk about, you know, go find somebody who breastfed successfully and ask them about breastfeeding. Dad, go find a husband whose wife breastfed successfully and ask him what he did. you know, that kind of thing. Again, it focuses a lot on tasks to accomplish. When you speak to men, you got to give them something to do, okay? We don't want to hear about how you got in the situation, where you are, or, you know, what your, you know, what dress she chose to wear and how it matched you and how you feel about it. We could care less. We're like, oh, you want a new dress? No problem. Let's get a new dress. I don't care why you want a new dress. I just want to fix the problem, right? And so with dads, that's what I focus on is what can you do to address the issue? What can you do to solve the problem? And it's extremely, you'd be amazed when you speak the right language. The interested dads come out of the woodwork everywhere. Every single one of them has something to say about breastfeeding. You just need to know how to get in.
How do you get guys to really help moms when you talked about just kind of close the door, the rest of the world, let them be on their own for a while, and let's just be here with baby for a couple of days? How do you get them to really understand the importance of that?
Again, it goes back with dad needs to know what tasks he's going to do while mom and baby are doing that. Okay. Dad needs to know what a good latch looks like. He needs to know how to solve a bad latch. He needs to know the basic troubleshooting things. He needs to be told that his job is to be the guardian of his family, the protector of the environment. When mom says do not disturb and they want to disturb her, dad needs to say, excuse me, we said do not disturb because mom is vulnerable. Dad is not. I'm working on the Cofective app redesign. It's a breastfeeding information app. One of our content experts is a mom, and she said the moment her baby was born, she was the most powerful and the most powerless that she had ever been in her life. She felt like she could do anything, and yet she was at the mercy of all these people around her, where she had to be accommodating and be a good patient. And dads don't have that feeling. Dads are like, hey, I want to get this accomplished. Let's move on. I don't have to be vulnerable. And so dads are a wonderful ally, so to speak, in the process where dads can say, hey, if you want to hold my baby, you have to bring food or do a chore. You know, that's the price to pay for coming in my room. What are you going to do? So I use dads as a gate guard to protect the environment, but also as a troubleshooter to help with achieving that.
What happens when you go into a home where you can see that the family dynamics are not conducive to calm, peaceful mom breastfeeding? In other words, there are other family members who are staying there for a couple of weeks. And yet when you're working privately with the mom, she's telling you that it's not a good situation. What do you do with that?
Oh, that is so difficult. And I wish I had a great answer that worked every time. And it unfortunately doesn't. But this is what my advice is. I'm very confrontational. I love to tell people that what they're doing is right or wrong, you know? And so when I've got the grandmother who is always offering the baby a bottle because the baby's hungry, I take that opportunity to re-educate the grandmother. And I say, I know you're trying to help and I know you want to solve the problem, but what you're doing is making it more difficult down the road. So, you know, what instead I want you to try is if the baby is doing this, I want you to take the baby to the mother. And it doesn't matter if the mother is sleeping. She can't sleep through a feeding anyway. Let's wake up the mother and get her involved. You know, that kind of thing. Because I honestly believe that everybody in the birth environment is doing what they think is best. And there's nobody there who's purposely sabotaging anything. But they sabotage all the time accidentally. They mean well, and they want to help, but they don't know how. And so they do the wrong thing because they don't know how to help. I firmly believe that everyone just needs to be told, this is how you can help best. You know, yes, it may be a little bit more difficult now, but it's going to pay dividends in the long run. Let's address that. And so, you know, I have a grandmother talk. I have a dad talk. I have a grandfather talk. I have a mom talk. I speak differently to each person in the environment based on what they need at the time. And I find it's more successful than not. It's definitely not 100%.
I think part of the problem for most people is that, especially the new parents, is that they don't want any family member to get angry at them. They feel like they don't want anybody to miss out on spending time with the baby. So there's lots of situations where people are suffering silently. And I love the fact that you said that you have the mom talk, the grandma talk, the grandpa talk. You know, you're just going to tell people right to their face exactly what it is. You know, they're lovingly doing something. They have the best interest, but how you explain to them how it's not helping the mom or the breastfeeding.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And one thing I tell parents, especially when I get them alone, is that birth is not a spectator sport. I could care less if Auntie Jane gets enough time holding the baby. Unless Auntie Jane is breastfeeding the baby, she's the wrong person to be holding the baby. I tell moms that if the baby is ever more than arm's distance away, they're making breastfeeding more difficult. And so the more time they can spend holding the baby, the better it's going to be. And with dads, I use the analogy of learning how to walk. You don't teach a kid to walk by hanging them from the ceiling and taking them down for 10 minutes every 2 to 3 hours and then putting them back on the ceiling again. No, you teach them to walk by putting them on the carpet and leaving them there for 10 to 20 hours a day. And they learn how to walk through experimentation. It's trial and error. And that's how babies learn to breastfeed. So when grandma's holding the baby so mom can sleep, it's not helping because baby can't learn how to breastfeed. Mom can't learn the cues when someone else is trying to help mom get more sleep. And I love to tell the story of when baby number one was born. My wife was a young Army Nurse Corps officer, and she had 6 weeks off and had to go back to work. And she was working in the NICU, and I was working as a cook. So obviously her sleep was more important than mine. And so I was going to do the 3 a.m. feeding so mom could get her sleep. And when the time came for she's got to go back to work and we're going to do a couple of dry runs, boy, I was ready for that 3 a.m. sleep feeding. I wasn't even asleep. And baby, you know, fussed just a little bit, and I snatched him up and ran downstairs and made the bottle and got everything ready. And I came upstairs to enjoy the rocking chair while I was feeding my baby so my lovely wife could get some sleep. And there she was, wide awake, pumping, because she couldn't sleep through a feeding either. And so I quickly learned that what she needed to learn how to do, and she figured it out before I did, but what we really learned was mom needed to learn how to feed in her sleep, and that we should all be asleep during the feeding. And so then it became very, very easy. But I realized that trying to help was not helpful at all. And all I was doing was making everybody miserable by trying to help like that. And it didn't need to be done.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I have that talk with couples all the time, trying to get them to understand that trying to let her sleep while you might take care of things is you just really need to put the mom and the baby together. And you need to figure out how to lay in bed and how to get some shut eye while your baby's feeding.
Taking a little break to let you know about the two groups that I am offering. Both these groups are for 3 months, and both will provide amazing opportunities for you to learn and grow with your peers. If you are feeling a lack of connection with other students or IBCLCs, these groups are what you've been waiting for and just what you need. There are two groups, one for student IBCLCs and one for IBCLCs. In our student IBCLC group, I've put together a group that many people say that they're really looking for. Feedback we've received clearly tells us that as students, you're studying alone and you're looking for things like accountability, help with specific topics you're struggling with, more group interaction. You'd love to do some role playing to get you familiar with all kinds of situations and family dynamics. You really want an experienced IBCLC leading your learning group, and that would be me. And you're also looking for opportunities to learn from other cultures. The feedback I've received from other IBCLCs who are in private practice or wanting to open their own private practice, this group is for you. And you're telling me that you're basically looking for everything, all the details of starting your own practice, helping in developing forms, advice on structuring your practice from marketing and advertising to scheduling to setting prices. You need help with learning how to set boundaries with your family life, with other healthcare providers, and with clients. You want help with how to best network and connect with your peers, how to figure out things like vacation time, saving money to go away on vacation. A lot of people are really struggling with how to make this a business and not a hobby. We're going to work on all of that. And everything that you need to know in order to be a successful IBCLC in your community with a private practice. For more details about the student group and the IBCLC group. If you're looking for registration, all you need to do is go to www.allaboutmothering.com, and on that page, you'll see links for those two groups. Now, back to the show.
So I don't know if you or any of your listeners went to the Gold Conference this year, but the Gold Conference was just amazing. That's the global online lactation discussion. Their keynote speaker was Amy Brown, and she was amazing. I loved her talk. But she mentioned that one of the problems that new parents have is that they bring this baby into the world, this other person, into their home, and then they try to pretend that that's not going to involve them, that that's not going to change their entire existence. And it so certainly does. Everything changes. Again, from the moment the pea hits the stick, everything changes. And they need to embrace the idea that they will never be the same again. And when you can embrace that idea, it's so much easier to work baby into your environment. But when you try to force baby to fit into your preconceived fantasy notions, it's doomed to failure.
Well, where did you ever learn that being a parent was a Monday to Friday, 9-to-5 job? You do have this perspective, and perhaps you've gotten into some frank discussions with some of the dads. One of the things that I struggle with, a mom who fiercely wants to breastfeed, it's actually going fairly well, but her husband is really giving her a lot of flack about breastfeeding and telling her that he misses them as a couple.
Sure, sure. And I always start with something positive, you know, because again, dad has the best interest of the couple at heart, even when he sounds selfish. Okay. So it's always something positive, something to the effect of, you know, I know that, you know, it's, you love your wife and that you miss being together as a couple. You know, but the world, it has to change when you have a child. You know, it goes back to that. You can't bring a baby into the world and expect them not to change everything about it. So you have to renegotiate your relationship to include the baby, because no matter what happens, the baby's going to be here every day for the rest of your life. You know, and it does no good to want your old life back. You never get to be 18 again, ever. You have to move on. You know, we don't get to be children for the rest of our lives. We don't get to be young couples for the rest of our lives. This is the progression, and we just have to embrace what is the new normal. You know, yes, you miss it. I miss it too. But guess what? I found something to take its place. So that's usually the way I go when
that's
I talk
about
it.
Great answer. I often struggle with that. I have to acknowledge that sometimes I do have my bias in that. Just exactly what you said. I have to always keep reminding myself that he actually does have the best interest, even if I think that he's sounding selfish, and to keep that forefront of my brain and start right with something positive. Because as a female and a mother, my first go-to is, well, that's pretty selfish of you. And so I have to remember that. So those right pearls of wisdom that you just shared will help many people, but it particularly really helped me.
Yeah. Well, one thing that's really important when you're talking to men is to understand that men actually do speak a different language. When a man gets angry or when a man becomes unreasonable, it usually means he's frightened or he's unsure. Okay. But he can't say, I'm afraid for what's happening right now. All he can say is, why is this badness happening? And whose fault is it that this badness is happening? Okay, so that's not really what he feels, but that's as close as he can get to expressing it, because he doesn't speak girl. He can't say, I'm vulnerable and I'm afraid. He has to come off strong, and he has to come off as being in charge. You could call it unfortunate, but it's just how men speak. Again, when it goes back to the idea that there's a positive reason, he's trying to help. He's just not doing it the way I would help. And so, you know, when you start with that, I think it makes everything easier. And understand that men don't always say what they mean, just like women don't always say what they mean, right? They're just trying to express themselves the best way that they know how, and yet still be who they are.
Well, you're supposed to read our minds.
Oh, yeah, of course. You know, I love to say that all women are crazy because they don't know what they want, but they expect me to know what they want. And what they want changes every 30 seconds. It's like an unsolvable puzzle that I work through
and
all day, every
stuck
day. Absolutely.
You're
we're supposed to be able to read your mind.
Solvable puzzle.
I'm stuck with it, right?
Tom, I know.
But it's a fun puzzle to try to solve.
It's so great to get the male perspective. I want to know, everybody, I mean, obviously, just by listening to you, we can tell that you really love what you're doing. You love to talk about fathers and birth and breastfeeding, and you're a fabulous speaker. I did hear you speak at a couple of conferences. I know you were at USLCA, and I know, or you're going to be, you have a webinar with them. And I also know you have one coming up with Gold Perinatal in October. So that's really cool, too.
Oh, yes. I love it. I love to teach. I'll teach anybody, anything, anytime.
That's
just
exactly
give me the chance.
What I wanted you to let us know. So where, if anybody here is in a capacity that has any conferences or is looking for someone to do webinars in this field, how could they contact you?
Well, the easiest way to contact me is through my LACSpeak page. I have a profile on the LACSpeak.com, which is a professional organization of lactation speakers. If anyone out there is planning a conference, I highly recommend go to LACSpeak.com. All of the world's best are there, and you can put together an amazing conference very easily on that page. But that's where that's the easiest way to find me from a professional's perspective. My email address, feel free to share it. It's jjohnston@methodist.edu, which is my college address. Feel free to write to me if you want to get a hold of me. I try to be as easy to reach as possible. I am on Facebook, again, under Gerald Johnston. And of course, it's misspelled, but it's J-A-R-O-L-D. Johnston has a T in it. I'd love to be as available as I can so people can, you know, write to me, ask me questions. I get people ask me questions all the time. Sometimes they're, you know, professional questions. Sometimes they're personal questions. And that's why I started that Sage Hom blog spot. And there's a Facebook page, too. I love when people ask me questions so I can try my best to answer them, because I learn a lot doing that. It's how I stay fresh. I don't just answer the question based on what I think I know. I go back and look it up because I stay in touch with the research that way. I've learned an awful lot of interesting stuff. Like, did you know that buffaloes make alpha 2 beta casein predominant?
Absolutely
milk
not. Who
instead
knew?
Of alpha 1? Who knew? Yeah. I had somebody who was baby was protein sensitive who needed to know if she could drink buffalo milk when she traveled to India next month.
I've never been asked that question before.
I'm currently in negotiations with an obstetrician who we have a shared patient that has polycystic ovarian syndrome, and she has some mammary hypoplasia. And she's struggled and didn't breastfeed successfully with her first baby. She wants to with the second baby. And we're trying to find ways to get her breast to develop during pregnancy. And he says, well, we can't do that. We can't do this. I don't really know what to do. I usually refer to lactation. And I say, great, I'm lactation. How do we solve the problem? Because I don't have the knowledge that you have. Let's work together on this. So I love collaborating that way. It opens the obstetrician's eyes to the greater world of things that need to be addressed. And I can tap in on his knowledge and see where, you know, his expertise in the endocrine system. Now, but if we have time, there's one thing I wanted to talk about. I have this system that I use for teaching dads about breastfeeding, and it's a military-based system. If any of your listeners are veterans, they'll get it. I tell all my dads, because I work with military fathers, I tell them that the Army taught you how to breastfeed in basic training. That basic rifle marksmanship and breastfeeding a baby is exactly the same thing. All you got to do is line up your front and rear sight posts, which is the baby's head, chest, and trunk. And if there's a problem, you pull on your charging handle, which is the baby's chin. So I use, in the Army, we have this analogy for corrective action on the M16 called sport, slap, pull, observe, release, tap, squeeze, or shoot. It's how you fix a weapon jam in an Army rifle, in one of those assault weapons. But I say you just apply it to the baby. Slap, put your hands behind the baby's back, press him toward the breast. Pull, reach in between the chin and the breast, grab his chin and pull down on his chin. Observe, do the cheeks puff out? Does jaw open up? Does pain go away? Release, let him go and let him suck again. Tap, try again. If that doesn't work after 3 or 4 taps, then shoot. You got a hopeless double feed. You're going to have to drop the magazine, clear the chamber, reload, put that sucker back together again. So take him off the breast, calm everything down, put him back on the breast again. So I use an analogy with some real hands-on knowledge that the dad can use. And for my dads who aren't military, I use sports like baseball, basketball, football. I say, you know, the same thing, support, pull, observe, release, try again, and shoot, we got to try again. So I use an analogy with real world hands-on skills when I'm teaching dads. And you'd be amazed how the light bulbs go off in dad's head when you say that kind of stuff to them. So it's sports for civilians or sports for the military. It works either way. So I tell all my lactation consultant friends, find the analogy that works for your population and apply it to the dads in your that you're working with. You'd be amazed how they come alive when you turn the right key.
That's such fabulous advice. And sometimes what I have done sort of along the same lines is I've said to dad, like, if I'm not like really getting through or making that connection, I've said to the guys, you know her better than I do. What do you think will help her, like, for instance, bring her baby rather quickly onto the breast? Because we know that moms are afraid of doing that. And so some guys will just find these analogies that'll click. It would be a story that they're telling the mom, a situation that happened, or something that I don't know that about the two of them, that he's able to bring to the surface, utilize that. And all of a sudden, it's like click, magic happened. And yep. I didn't really do anything, and it works.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. I mean, what I said before, like I like to learn new things, but the whole military stuff isn't going to come easy to me. So I love that you shared that, because there's going to be plenty of people that are going to pick up on that, and that's going to work for them.
Sure. And the trick is that it's what works in my population, and everybody has to figure out what works in their population and apply it. But the more real world things you can give a dad to do, the easier it's going to be. Another thing that I like to talk about is that everybody has a set of tools that they come with. Moms have an amazing set of tools. Their skin is different. Their face is different. Their voice, their smell, the breast, everything is perfect for feeding babies. But dad has a tool that mom doesn't have. It's called an Adam's apple. And when baby isn't hungry, dads are better at calming the baby than mom is. You put the baby up on your bare chest. You're nice and cuddle in with them and use that deep boy voice and go, hello, baby. How are you doing? And it's a full body massage for the baby because his chest vibrates when he speaks. And baby will bury into dad's chest and go, oh, where have you been all my life? And dads are very good at soothing the baby when he's not hungry. And I always like to tell people that one of the biggest mistakes that we make in the maternal child realm is that we teach new couples these foolish things called hunger signs or feeding cues. They're not hunger signs at all. They're stress signs. Whether he's hungry, cold, lonely, wet, dirty diaper, pain, it doesn't matter what's wrong. Baby's going to suck on his hands, center, squirm, and fuss. That doesn't mean he's hungry. It means he's fussy. How many times do you offer a baby the breast? He sucks once or twice, pulls away, and cries. Because he doesn't want to eat, but he's instinctively driven to suck. When the baby does that, give him to dad. Dad's Adam's apple will soothe that baby right down, and then mom doesn't have to worry about it.
Well, I'll tell you, I got tons of information from chatting with you, but that's probably going to be the highlight, because in all my years of doing this work, I have never heard that. Never heard the whole Adam's apple.
Oh, wow. Oh, dads are amazing that
way. It absolutely makes sense. I mean, you know, and the guys, it's funny because I'm sure you hear this all the time. Moms are like, I can't calm the baby down. Once the baby's fed and everything, there's other stuff going on. I have no idea what to do, but dad is great at it. And I don't know what he does. He does something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, part of that something that he's doing is cuddling the baby really close to his chest. Yep. And there's probably that whole Adam's apple deep voice vibration thing going on that I never connected with.
Yep. Yeah. You know, how do we calm soothing babies? Rhythmic and vibration, those two things. You know, you got the vibrating car seats. You put them in the car and take them for a drive. It's always rhythmic and vibrating. Dads are rhythmic and vibrating. So the way I figured that out is in my family, mom feeds the babies and I put them to bed. And so when babies are old enough to be sleeping alone, it becomes my nightly task to put them to bed. And so every night I would sing to the baby their own particular lullaby. And each of my 8 babies had their own lullaby. And I would sing that song over and over and over again until they fell asleep. And I quickly learned that it was my deep rumbling voice while I was singing and holding them close to my chest that was so very soothing. And so I teach that to all my dads that, you know, it's foolish to say that he can't bring anything to the table. He has an innate set of male skills that he's going to bring to the table that's going to impact that relationship. The problem with mom is that whenever baby is around mom, he thinks about lunch. She smells like lunch. It's the breasts are perfect, and it's what he thinks about all day, every day. But there are times when he doesn't need them, and mom's breasts get confusing for the baby. They want to suckle because they have to, but they don't want to eat. So what do? You give them to somebody who doesn't have breasts. But I warn dads, baby can't tell mom's nipples from dad's nipples. And if he sees your nipples, dad, he will latch onto them. And that's like lightning bolt. I don't know. Women are designed differently than men because it does not feel anything good at all when baby latches onto our breasts. They're like, holy cow. I almost dropped my first son when he did that the first time. So dad's got to wear pasties or something to protect his nipples because he doesn't want baby getting on dad's nipples.
That's so funny because lots of times
doesn't work very well.
We talk about skin to skin and dad to take their shirts off, right?
Yep. Yep. Yeah. We love to have dads do skin to skin. I always warn them, cover the nipples because he'll find them. I promise. That's what babies are designed to do, is find something round and brown.
You have a fabulous sense of humor about a lot of things, but in particular about the breastfeeding. And I tell you, I've learned a lot. I'm like, as you're talking, I see a new blog post coming up on the tools that dads have. Again, I think I just wind up saying the same old things, which are all good and all true. But I love things that are fresh, love things that are coming from a guy, because more than likely I'll hit the nail on the head rather than wondering if this is going to fit for them and resonate with them.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's what I love about sharing ideas between colleagues is, you know, you learn so much when you talk to other people. And I feel that everyone's practice needs to be kind of an amalgam of the people around us, you know. This works well for me. This not so well. This works okay for me. I'll pick up a little of this and a little of that. And you kind of build your own thing. But you can take heart that, you know, when you say the same thing over and over again, you're usually saying it to different people.
I do recognize that, but I still, for my own brain, sometimes I like to stay new and different. And I just loved, I mean, you shared so many great things that my listeners can take away. And just in the last part of this conversation, you know, one of the big takeaways for my listeners should be, you know, for the ladies to talk to the guys that they do come to this whole breastfeeding thing with a whole bunch of tools. And because, I mean, I'm sure you hear about this all the time, too. Dads think that the only way that they can, quote unquote, bond with their baby is to do what? Feed the baby milk from a bottle. And so everybody's so anxious to do that. And there are many ways that we know that can bond with their baby. But you've just added a couple of really great ones that I think that moms can also use to share with the dads. And just, again, the legitimacy of hearing it come from a very experienced father who has 8 children, but is also working in the field of birth and lactation, that when they share that with their husbands, that they know it's coming from a place of experience, and more than likely they will hit the nail on the head when they're going to share a few things with their husbands too. So thank you so much. I appreciate you.
Oh, absolutely. Sure. So, you know, whenever I have a dad who says that he's jealous, that he wants to be able to feed the baby too, because he wants to love the baby, I always tell him, you know, I'm a pretty fat guy, right? I'm a big guy, weigh 230 pounds, and I love Five Guys hamburgers, but I don't even know the name of the kid who gives me the hamburger. I don't love people who feed me. I love people who love me, you know? And so, you know, yes, there's a lot of love that passes back and forth between a mom and a baby while she's breastfeeding, but it's not because milk is flowing into his mouth. It's because mom is cuddling the baby and staring lovingly into his eyes, and she grooms him, and that's where the love comes from. It's not the milk that makes the love. It's the cuddling and the holding and the eye contact that makes the love. And dads can do that just as well as moms can. They don't need breasts to do that. You know, and that's a really important thing. And I tell them, you know, babies only eat for 20 to 30 minutes, 8 to 12 times a day. They're spending like 8 hours a day breastfeeding. That means dad has 16 hours a day when he could be loving on that baby. And that's twice as much time as mom needs. You can't tell me that's not enough love time. You know, dad, I recognize you want to love your baby, and that's wonderful. This is how you can love your baby. It's different from how mom loves the baby. But it's the exact same thing. It's the cuddling, not the milk, that causes the love.
Well, thank you, Tom, so much. Is there any one last thing that you want to share, or do you feel like we've done good today?
I'm afraid if we go down that road, we'll do another hour. And while I've got the time, I know this has to end sooner or later. So I think we're good.
Well, you're very easygoing guy. You have many years of experience and expertise, and you've given us a little snippet, which I think has been, when I say a little snippet in time, but not as far as the information. And again, I encourage anybody here in my audience who has any conferences coming up that they're looking for speakers, I imagine you're going to want to call up Tom Johnston. So thank you so much, Tom.
Well, thank you for that. It's been a pleasure. We should do this again sometime.
Yes, sir. You take care and have a wonderful day.
And you too. Bye now.
Now you can see why I was so excited to have you hear this show. Tom had so many good things to say about so many different ways that as professional IBCLCs, we could be more helpful to parents and how to bring guys into the discussion about breastfeeding. I learned a lot. All this pertains to pregnant and new moms also. You learned that you need to give the guys tasks to do, make them take action, make sure they attend breastfeeding class so they know as much about position and latch as you do, so they can be very helpful in the early days with the knowledge that they've learned. It's easy for you to help them find ways to be helpful with a bunch of tips that Tom gave us. I like what Tom said about dads being guardians and protectors of their wives during a time when moms tend to feel vulnerable. So many words of wisdom that Tom Johnston shared. This is definitely a shout out to any person who is looking for speakers for their organization or conference. I highly recommend Tom. He is knowledgeable, easygoing, and a pleasure to work with. I hope everyone got many different things out of the show because I know that I did. Thanks so much for joining me and hanging out with me today. Don't forget those four words, all about breastfeeding community. Search them in Facebook and join our group. Until the next show, bye-bye.